Hello. Today we are going to discuss a very important module that is titled Relevance of Gender Dimensions in Teaching and Learning Processes. Before we delve deeper into the discussion of this module, let me begin by introducing myself. I am Professor Millie Roy Anand from the Department of Gender Studies.
Namaskar. I am Professor Mona Yadav from the Department of Gender Studies.
Okay. So we can begin the discussion of the module. Before we delve deeper into the theme, I would like to read out a quote. We must accept that the social and educational profile of the classroom is multi-class, multi-caste, multi-religious, and gendered with disability as a significant dimension of the profile of children in classrooms. Thus, classroom consists of learners who belong to diverse ethnic, racial, cultural, linguistic, and socio-economic backgrounds, including children with special needs. And gender cuts across all these categories at varied levels. This quote clearly expresses the importance of gender and how it interplays at various levels. The main objectives of developing this module is to identify existing gender-biased attitudes and behavior among teachers and students, develop gender-sensitive pedagogic processes in transaction of various disciplines, and also enable teachers to adopt variety of learning activities that foster a gender-sensitive classroom environment.
Thank you, Millie, for giving the objectives of the module. Here I would like to tell you the brief about this module. Actually, the module has been written to give a gender perspective in the classroom situation, in the teaching learning process, how teachers can integrate gender as a whole into the teaching learning process and in the pedagogical processes. And in this, we have given some examples from our textbooks itself so that it is not very difficult for the teachers to integrate these concerns into the any of the disciplines that we talk of, whether it is sciences, whether it is mathematics, whether it is languages, or whether it is social sciences. So it gives a brief about how to integrate these concerns, change their own mindsets, and how to bring about a change in the mindsets of the students. And it also addresses certain learning outcomes, as have been given in our learning outcome document also. One of them is how to, it helps to understand the role of curriculum and textbooks in enhancing education and empowerment of girls. It helps to examine critically and question the existing stereotypic attitudes and biases related to gender. It helps in recognizing and appreciating the participation and contribution of women in the various fields. And we have also talked of how it can be integrated into the various disciplines also.
And I think the best person to use pedagogical interventions is the teacher in the classroom, because the teacher has a very important role to play in creating a gender-sensitive environment in the classroom, how to use teaching learning resources, and how to transact them, keeping in mind that her classroom is a multi-class and multi-class classroom, which has gender cutting across all these levels. But we should not forget that teachers themselves, when they enter the classroom, they themselves enter with their prejudices, their own stereotypes, their own biased attitudes. We do not blame them. We cannot blame them, because that's how they're socialized into believing so. Therefore, it is very important for the teacher, before she embarks on new practices and teaching learning interventions, she has to undo the baggage of prejudices and biases that she may have imbibed during her own socialization processes. Along with integration, the teacher also needs to understand that her classroom is also full of learners who belong to the marginalized sections of society. So how do we bring them on board? How do we make them comfortable in the classroom? For example, girls from marginalized communities like the scheduled castes and scheduled tribes, they often feel alienated in their own classroom. It could be because of the behavior of the teacher or the students themselves. So therefore, the teacher has a very important role to play on how to devise pedagogical practices through her transaction activities.
As very well said again, that not only the transaction strategies, there's something called as a hidden curriculum. Now, what do we mean by the hidden curriculum? Hidden curriculum is the informal socialization of the children which happens in the classroom or in the school environment itself. And we all know that gender is a part of this hidden curriculum, because what happens is, in the hidden curriculum, the children learn a lot of biases through their own socialization, and even the biases taken up by the teacher. The bias biases can be in the form of the organization arrangement of the classroom. It can be in the form of the spaces that is being provided to the children, because often we see the kind of spaces which are provided to the boys and the girls. And even when we talk of the spaces, the sports equipment, the sports spaces, because generally boys are seen to occupy the whole of the playground and girls are restricting themselves to the classroom or in and around the classroom. So what kind of biases perpetuate? This module also talks about and how teachers have to overcome these biases, not only in the spaces itself, but how do they discipline the kind of activities? Because again, for example, we can think of when there is any chief guest who's coming, who gives the bouquet. So these things need to be pondered, that are we in subtle way giving certain informations to the children that this is the kind of roles which they can only play, or do we give them a wider space and a wider forum and all the kind of activities to be organized by all of them? And this module also talks of the various disciplines that we were talking of, that how in the various discipline it can be integrated. For example, let's take an example of a languages. This module also talks of how through various languages, in which these in the module only two languages we have taken, that is English and Hindi, how through teaching of English we can deal the gender concerns, because we all know that languages cut across all the disciplines, and it is very important for our language to be gender neutral and gender inclusive. Like, there is a very generic common term, as you see in languages we use man, so why to use man? Why cannot we use alternative like humans? So it is very important that we need to think of how languages have to be used when we are using in any discipline that we talk of. Even when we use languages in the sciences, when you use languages in the mathematics, and of course in social sciences, and per se as we talk of the language subject itself. Here in this module also, as you can see, you would be seeing it, that there is examples which have been given from our textbooks. One of the examples have been given of a story which is given in Marigold, where there is a story of a king and a queen of Manipur, and how they have three sons and one daughter, and now there is a selection of an heir for the kingdom, and how it is in the culture that the eldest son is to be part of, or has to be made as the heir of the kingdom, but how they change the mindset in their own thinking itself and break this patriarchal mindset, and how they give because of certain activities being given to the girl child, and how she performs in those activities, and how she has a perseverance to be a queen to that kingdom and becomes the heir of that kingdom. Similarly, we have other examples in our languages also, like in Hindi also. Hamare Hindi mein bhi kuch aisi bhashaein hain, kyunki hame hamara ye manna hai ki Hindi ke andar bhi agar hum kuch aisi cheeze use karte, apna bhasha ka prayog us tarah se kare jisme hum keval ek hi gender ko address na kare, to zyada fayda hota hai, kyunki kahin na kahin teachers apni bhasha ke madhyam se hum kahein purushatva ko ya naritva ko badhava dete hain. To kis tarah se hum लैंग्वेज को अपना इंक्लूसिव बना सकते हैं, ये बहुत ज़रूरी है कि हम अपनी लैंग्वेज को इंक्लूसिव बनाएं और अपनी भाषा को सरल और सबको इंक्लूड करते हुए बनाएं. I think you can talk of social sciences.
I think Professor Mona Yadav has made a very valid point, because it's no more about replacing he with she. Yeah. You know, we have to talk about people. We have to talk about humans. So language indeed plays a very important role in how we are able to write our textual narrative, and how we are able to express how both men and women contributed equally in the development processes. Now, taking on from languages, I think I'll delve into social sciences. I think social sciences is one discipline which has enormous scope of adding these dimensions of, you know, questioning gender stereotypes, of questioning received ideas and institutions, because what social science does is it seeks to explore individual and collective human behavior, and how such human behavior influence traditions, institutions, norms, families, ideas and values. Therefore, what social sciences does is to provide a critical lens both to the student and the teacher. So by wearing a critical lens, what do we purpose to do? We need to acknowledge and respect diversity in terms of gender, religion, caste and class. We need to acknowledge that there's not just one caste or one creed. There are multiple castes and creeds, and also now we have the third gender. We need to look into the third gender as well. The next important thing which social sciences does is helps us deliberate upon issues which affect our everyday lives. Issues such as democracy and autocracy, power and governance, caste, race, gender and patriarchy, stereotypes and prejudices. Other than exploring, other than examining, we need to also critically analyze the political, social, economic institutions and other dimensions of inequality which stare us at our face and which are also affecting the lives of children every day. And other than exploring and examining and critically analyzing, we also need to question the received ideas and institutions and practices. So this is what social science strives to do. And that is why we've taken up one particular theme in the social science section, that is questioning and examining received ideas, institutions, and practices. So we've given examples from the political science textbook, how in the beginning of the 20th century, we had a very eminent personality called Begum Rokeya Shekhawat Hussain, a noted educationist and literary figure who started schools for Muslim girls in Patna and Calcutta. That was way back in the early 20th century. So you can imagine how conservative the society was at that time. But she had the guts to question the religious leaders on why women had to be accorded such a very stereotyped place in society. So she wrote a book called Sultana's Dream in 1905, in which Sultana reaches a place called Ladyland. So Ladyland is a place where women had the freedom to study and work and dared to dream. So at that time, Begum Shekhawat Rokeya Hussain was actually trying to make a very pertinent point. She raised an issue, and today we have somebody called Lakshmi Lakra, who is the first woman engine driver of the Northern Railways. She hails from a very poor family, Lakshmi. She studied hard, but she challenged stereotype norms and institutions, and she chose to be a engine driver. So this is how social sciences has a lot of scope of integrating the perceptions and the dimensions of various sections of society.
Even the economic textbooks that we have discussed in this, that how economics textbooks can also involve gender perspective, because economy is such a subject where there is a lot of lacking into how gender can be weaved in and how gender perspective can be weaved in, because women play a very important role in the economic development of the country. And similarly, as Millie has just said, we have also talked of mathematics as well as sciences also in our module when we have written this module, because mathematics, as you all very well know, that it is considered, both mathematics and sciences are considered to be the so-called masculine subjects, though they are not. And math specifically, because even when we go to the schools and in the higher classes rather, what happens if we do not have a math section, and some of these schools, they do not even have a science section in the girls' schools, because it is considered that the so-called maths is more boys take up the maths and the sciences. But of course now the myths are breaking, and of course now we have girls taking up a lot of sciences, and we have schools which have all these sections in the school. And mathematics is such a subject wherein maximum we can build in lot of data and lot of statistics, and how women have an important role to play. Because a simple example, like latest census, it's just happened in 2011. We can consider the example of census 2011, wherein we can give the data and we can ask them, what is the sex ratio? So in the sex ratio, they can find out that what is the ratio of the male to the female. And this is how we can sensitize them, that why women are less than the males. This is how we have to sensitize our students. Not only that, there are wages rules, there are population issues, there are so many issues which can be addressed. There are how women can be in the banking roles. We show through our statements, like problem statements and other statements, that how women play a very important role into the mathematics also. Through mathematics, we can give an examples like how property has to be distributed in a family, because generally it is said that women are not the owners of the property, and they're even considered, when the property is distributed, though there is a law, but still in many of the places they do not give their share, women are not given the share in the property. So how this can be portrayed through a mathematical problem, it is very, very important, because mathematics is such a subject where we can touch various aspects where the women have been lacking in these fields. And similarly, as you can see in the module also, we've given an example wherein the math magic at the primary level give example where women have portrayed productive and decision-making roles, such as they are shown as entrepreneurs, they have been shown as farmers, they have been shown as property owners, and male characters have also been engaged, and they have been shown in the household chores and cooking also. So women have been portrayed as standing for their rights, thus challenging the power relations. So we have such examples in our own textbooks, which can be picked up. The teachers can also pick up other examples also. Need not be, because we believe in the teacher should not be restricted, a teacher should not restrict herself to the textbooks only, but she should take examples from their own local areas, from their own societies, so that children can gel with it. Then, of course, we have sciences, as we have talked of. Sciences, again, we have certain examples in sciences, and sciences can play a major role in breaking the myths, because generally it is said that the physical differences make them play the roles that they are playing. But when we talk of the sciences, we can say who determines the sex of the child. This can be addressed. And of course, in our examples itself, we have taken the example of two women, wherein one of the women is from the Jharkhand. This is a part of her textbook. And she has Suramani. She's a tribal woman, and she's from the community, Jharkhand community. And she believes in preserving of the forest of her state. Then we have another example of Darkimai from Alwar, who has helped in solving the water problem in her village. So we have local examples. So we need to look in for local examples, where local examples can be used by the teachers and how they can undo the biases. And it is very important, Millie, as we all know, that we now to have to make our boys address patriarchy. Because we have talked enough, so here the teacher has to play an important role, where she can address the biases which have been perpetuated. And of course, at the end, we have the evaluation, which talks of how, after reading the module, the teacher can evaluate themselves, whether how much sensitized they have been towards this issue. Because unless and until, as Millie said, if the teacher is not sensitized herself, then she cannot sensitize the students. So she has to undo her own learning and her own sensitization. And we hope with this module, the teacher will be able to sensitize herself first and then make the teaching learning process more gender sensitive. Now, over to Millie. I think Millie would conclude.
Since this module is primarily for the leadership package, so we'll be addressing principles on how to use this module. But we hope that the principles will be oriented adequately and also take the orientation forward and help the teachers to transact these modules in the classroom. So now it's actually a partnership between the principals and the teachers on how they're able to integrate gender dimensions in the classroom. Thank you.